In the third and last video of this course, we are moving to the interior of the scene, where we will be creating day and night shots. In the process, we will learn how to create Thea models, place lights, use the Relight Editor, and control the camera parameters. In order to set up the interior scene for daylight, we need to adjust the tone mapping. Let us first adjust the sun position. Just like in the exterior video, we will enable LUT and use the false color LUT to adjust the exposure. The scene is dark and a way to adjust the exposure is by adjusting the ISO, shutter speed and f-number values. The first step is to change the tone mapping method from standard to filmic. In this case, we will adjust the filmic parameters to bring up the shadows. Additionally, we will lower the shutter speed value to 180 and f-number to 2.8. Let's finally lower the highlights value to compensate for the overexposed areas while keeping the overall brightness of the image. Let's move on by populating the scene with Thea models from the content browser. Here is how the interior daylight scene looks like. Let's continue setting up the scene for a night shot. The first thing that we need is to add lights to the scene. Thea for Rhino makes use of the native Rhino lights. We will create a spotlight and adjust its falloff. Let us also move it closer to the ceiling. We will now use the array command to create a 3x4 grid of the spotlight. The next step is to add a point light inside the table lamp. We will finally add an area light coming from the left side of the camera view. With the lights added to the scene, it is time to open the lights panel and turn off both the sun and skylight. This leaves us only with the lights that we created in the previous step. After starting interactive rendering, one thing we notice is that the scene is too dark. The spotlights have an intensity of 100 watts that should be enough for the scene. Thea should be treated like a real camera, and just like it happens in the real world, instead of increasing the light's intensity, we will adjust the exposure of the camera. We will switch to the display settings tab and adjust the ISO, shutter speed and f-number values to standard exposure settings for a night shot. With the exposure corrected, we can now fine-tune the intensity of the light. The last thing is to add an environment map to get that bluish tint from the windows. We will go to the Environment tab and load an HDR image to the image-based lighting channel. The intensity of the environment needs to be adjusted, so let's decrease its power. Here is how the night shot looks so far. Let's have a look at how lights work with the Relight Editor. We will be using this simple scene to understand how the lights are grouped in the Relight Editor. To enable Relight, go to the Render Settings tab, expand the Common Rollout, and tick the Relight checkbox. With Relight enabled, we may move on to the first case where we have several spotlights. After rendering the scene, we see that each light has its own Relight controls. we can group lights together and create Relight groups. Let's select the first two spotlights and use the group command. As you can see, we now have two Relight groups. The first one is the lights that we grouped together and the remaining spotlight. Finally, we have the mesh emitters. A mesh emitter is any surface having an emitting material assigned to it. Here we have four surfaces. We have applied the warm emitting material to the first two. The other two are using the cool emitting material. Let's render again and notice that the lights are grouped by their emitting material. Now that we understand how lights are grouped in Relight, we can go back to the scene. One of the benefits of using Relight is that we can create several images from one render. Before rendering the scene, we should group all the spotlights together so that we can modify them all at once. Let's go to the render settings and turn on Relight. We are now ready to start rendering the image. Here is the list of all the light groups in the scene that we can modify to create different lighting setups. First, we will have a look at the Relight options. Every light group has its own controls. The toggle switch turns the light group on and off. The solo button isolates the selected light. The value displayed here is a multiplier of the light's intensity. And finally, the color of the light. Right above the light groups, we have three buttons. The first one creates a snapshot of the current settings. Let's make changes to the light groups and create a few snapshots. We can create as many snapshots as we like and double-click on them to load the Relight settings. The next button resets the controls to their default values. Finally, the third button toggles the visibility of the light groups all at once. One thing that you need to be aware of is that you can save the image as an img.thea file, which can be reopened with the Relight information stored in it. The next topic has to do with depth of field. This effect is disabled by default and it can be enabled from the camera tab. Let's see the two options that turn depth of field on. If we expand the depth of field rollout, we can see that the type is set to disabled. To turn it on, we need to select one of the other two options. Let's see how they work. The first option is the F number. Low values will give us a shallow depth of field, while high values result in a deep depth of field. The other option is called sharpness. Low values create a less sharp image, similar to what we described as a shallow depth of field. Let's switch back to the F-number option and learn about the focal point. When autofocus is enabled, Thea will focus to the object in the center of the camera view. In this case, the sculpture is in the center of it. Let's see how to manually set the focal point when autofocus is disabled. We can either enter a value, or do this interactively in the Thea Darkroom window. Let's open the Thea Darkroom window and start rendering in interactive mode. We can use the Pick Camera Focus button to set the camera focal point. Batch rendering is the process of adding different views and rendering them one by one. Let's see how batch rendering works in Thea for Rhino. The place where we control batch rendering is from the Render Queue tab. Let's open the Thea Darkroom window and switch to the Render Queue tab. It appears empty because we need to click on the Refresh button to get all the named views from Rhino. Now that we have the named views, we can use the checkboxes to decide which of the named views will be rendered in batch. By right-clicking over an entry, we can either delete it or use the Edit functionality. Let's click on Edit and see what we can modify. We can define the resolution, the termination criteria, the engine, and finally if we would like to have the image denoised or not. We can have different settings per name view. Once we're done setting up the render queue, we can click on the Process button. We will be asked for the path and the name of the rendered images. The named view will be added after the name that we defined. This brings us to the end of this course. Thank you for watching.